أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد والثناء لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
ولعنة الله على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Brothers and sisters, ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is our third session in discussing Surah An'aam, which is the sixth surah of the Holy Quran. And we mentioned that this surah is particularly significant in the early history of Islam, as it was one of the final surahs that was revealed during the Meccan period, when the Muslim Ummah and the Holy Prophet were boycotted after they faced fierce opposition, and essentially the entire Arabian Peninsula turned against them and they had no place of refuge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals this surah to console the Holy Prophet, to remind him that the struggle that you are facing now is not something that is new. The prophets of the past had endured similar challenges. So you find this surah is essentially a surah of hope. The Muslims are demoralized. There doesn't seem to be any light at the end of the tunnel. So Surah Al-An'am is revealed to allow the Holy Prophet and the small, fragile Muslim community to see that light at the end of the tunnel. Alhamdulillah, we were able to cover verses 1-5, and inshallah, with Allah Azza wa Jalla's help, we'll be covering verses 6-10 tonight. So I'd like to turn your attention to ayah number 6 of Surah Al-An'am. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَمْ يَرَوْا كَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ مِنْ قَرْنٍ مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَا لَمْ نُمَكِّنْ لَكُمْ وَأَرْسَلْنَا السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْهِمْ مِدْرَارًا وَجَعَلْنَا الْأَنْهَارَ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهِمْ فَأَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ بِذُنُوبِهِمْ وَأَنْشَأْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ قَرْنًا آخَرِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah, He says, have they not considered how many a generation we destroyed before them? We had established them on earth more firmly than we established you. And we sent the sky upon them with abundant rains, and we made rivers flow beneath them. Then we destroyed them for their sins and brought into being after them another generation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran, He frequently mentions previous nations, ancient civilizations that were destroyed for their iniquity and their refusal to accept the teachings of the ancient prophets. And you find that this is a common theme, especially among the Meccan surahs. Now in this specific ayah, when Allah says, أَلَمْ يَرَوْا كَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ مِنْ قَرْنٍ, have they not considered how many a generation we destroyed before them? They, in this ayah, according to most of the Mufassirin, they say this is a reference to Quraysh. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing Quraysh. Now Quraysh, as many of you know, they are the most powerful tribe in the Arabian Peninsula. Numerically, they're their largest. They have the most resources. They're the most wealthy. Militarily, they are the most advanced. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't directly threaten them with punishment. He doesn't say that I'm going to punish you and I'm going to send down my wrath because you rejected the communications, my communications through the Holy Prophet. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala poses a rhetorical question to them. He poses a question for them to consider. Allah says, don't you see that there are nations that came before you that were more powerful than you, and yet I still destroyed them because of their transgressions? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran here and elsewhere warns that some of the destroyed peoples of the past were in fact stronger and better established than Quraysh, but were nonetheless utterly destroyed for their iniquity. I'd like to share with you a few verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala delivers a very similar message to Quraysh. For example, if you go to Surah Al-Fajr, verses 6 to 13, and ideally if everyone can have a copy of the Quran with them, or if you have a Quran app so you can follow along, because I find that one of the most effective ways to study the Quran is to cross-reference verses, because you come across a verse and there are other verses that are similar to it that when you examine it, you get a more complete picture of what the Quran is trying to convey. So Allah here is warning, he's asking the Quraysh that I want you to think about something. You think that you are powerful, that you are invincible. Let me remind you that there are nations, there were civilizations before you that were even more powerful, and I still destroyed them for their transgressions. So don't think that you are too powerful to suffer destruction. So if you look at Surah Al-Fajr, verses 6 through 13, Allah says, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِعَادٍ. Have you seen what your Lord did to the nation, to the community of Ad? Now Ad was an ancient civilization whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Prophet Hud to preach to them. And they refused and they ridiculed Hud. إرم ذات العماد, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the ancient civilization of Iram. Iram could be a city or it could be the name of a tribe. They were known for their outstanding engineering expertise. They were able to erect these magnificent pillars. So they were architecturally very advanced. التي لم يخلق مثلها في البلاد. Allah speaks about Iram, the people of Iram. He says they were able to construct pillars and structures that no one was able to match. وَثَمُودَ الَّذِينَ جَابُوا الصَّخْرَ بِالْوَادِ. Allah then speaks about Thamud, the ancient people of Thamud, whom Allah sent Nabi Saleh to propagate his message. Allah says, وَثَمُودَ الَّذِينَ جَابُوا الصَّخْرَ بِالْوَادِ. Thamud was so advanced that they were able to carve out homes and dwellings in the mountains. وَفِرْعَوْنَ ذِي الْأَوْتَادِ. Fir'aun, the one who possessed the tent poles. This is a reference to Fir'aun's military might. الَّذِينَ طَغَوْا فِي الْبِلَادِ. These people, Thamud, Ad, Fir'aun, these ancient civilizations, they transgressed in the land. They spread corruption. فَأَكْثَرُوا فِيهَا الْفَسَادِ. And then what does Allah say in Ayah 13? فَصَدَّ عَلَيْهِمْ رَبُّكَ سَوْطَ عَذَابِ. Despite the fact that they were so powerful and they were so militarily advanced and economically prosperous, Allah said, I poured my punishment upon them because of their rejection of the truth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is telling Quraysh that, listen, don't think that you're invincible. Just look at what happened to those who came before you. If you look at Surah Maryam, ayah number 74, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, he echoes the same message to the disbelievers of 7th century Arabia. He says, وَكَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا قَبْلَهُمْ مِنْ قَرْنٍ هُمْ أَحْسَنُ أَثَاثًا وَرِئِيَا. Allah says, and how many a nation, how many a people have we destroyed before them who were more powerful, who were more mighty than they were? In Surah Muhammad, Surah 47, ayah number 13, again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala points to this reality. He says, وَكَأَيِّن مِّن قَرْيَةٍ. And this verse was revealed when the Prophet was banished from Mecca, when he was driven out, when he was forced to migrate from Mecca to Medina. وَكَأَيِّن مِّن قَرْيَةٍ هِيَ أَشَدُّ قُوَّةٍ مِّن قَرْيَتِكَ الَّتِي أَخْرَجَتْكَ. أَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ فَلَا نَاصَرَ لَهُمْ. Allah tells the Holy Prophet that, and how many nations did we destroy before Quraysh, who are more powerful. These people who have driven you out of your home, Ya Rasulullah, don't worry about them. I have destroyed nations who are much more sophisticated and advanced than Quraysh. And when my punishment descended, فَلَا نَاصِرَ لَهُمْ, these people found that there was no one to help them. There was no one who would be able to help them escape my wrath when it descended upon them. In Surah Qaf, Surah 50, Ayah 36, Allah says again, وَكَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا قَبْلَهُمْ مِنْ قَرْنٍ هُمْ أَشَدُّ مِنْهُمْ بَطْشًا فَتَنَقَّبُوا فِي الْبِلَادِ هَلْ مِنْ مَحِيصٍ. Allah says, and how many nations before them did we destroy who were أَشَدُّ مِنْهُمْ بَطْشًا, who had more military might than these Quraysh had. فَتَنَقَّبُوا فِي الْبِلَادِ هَلْ مِنْ مَحِيصٍ. Allah says, when my punishment came down, they were running frantically from side to side, asking, is there a refuge? Is there a safe haven for us? When Allah's punishment descends, there is no safe haven. In the story of Prophet Nuh, Nuh's son, he thought that he could seek refuge by going to the peak of the highest mountain. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Nuh tells his son that there is no escape when Allah's punishment descends. So the beginning of ayah number 6 is a warning for the tribe of Quraysh, that you are opposing Rasulullah you are vehemently opposing my messenger. You think that you are invincible. You think you are too powerful to suffer destruction. Allah says, let me remind you. Do you remember what happened to Ad? Do you remember what happened to Thamud? Do you remember what happened to Fir'aun? There are many nations before you that were far more powerful, and yet they were utterly destroyed for their transgression. And then Allah continues with the verse. وَأَرْسَلْنَا السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْهِمْ مِدْرَارًا وَجَعَلْنَا الْأَنْهَارَ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهِمْ. Allah is speaking again about these ancient civilizations. Allah says, I sent the sky upon them with abundant rain, and I made the rivers flow beneath them. So Allah is saying that water used to come from above and there was water from below. And most of these civilizations were agricultural societies. So here when Allah says there was abundant rain, there were rivers, these are indicators of economic prosperity, that Allah is saying that these civilizations, these nations that I destroyed because of their iniquity, they were extremely wealthy. They were economic superpowers. But because of their defiance and their rebelliousness, Allah says, my punishment descended upon them. فَأَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ بِذُنُوبِهِمْ. These nations were not destroyed randomly. Allah says the reasons why these nations perished was not because of random natural disasters. Allah says there is nothing random in my creation. فَأَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ بِذُنُوبِهِمْ. What caused the downfall and the decline of all of the superpowers of the past was what? Allah says the main reason was what? Their sins, their rejection of truth, their defiance, their rebelliousness. And this is a lesson for superpowers of our time, that no superpower should think that it's invincible, that they have the most powerful military and they'll never suffer destruction. Allah says, if you are not moral, if you do not uphold justice, you will face the same fate as Ad, as Thamud, as the community of Lut, as Fir'aun. Allah says, I brought down superpowers in the past for their rejection of truth, for their corruption, for their injustice. And this is my sunnah, and it will continue until the day of Qiyamah. It's interesting to note that from a Quranic perspective, human actions can trigger natural disasters. Our actions have an impact on the natural world. Allah says, I destroyed them, whether it's through a flood, whether it's through an earthquake, I destroyed them because of their sins, meaning These natural disasters that afflicted these past nations were caused, of course, it has its own natural causes, but the cause behind these natural causes are the actions of man. You find that there's a beautiful hadith from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullahi alayhi, Allahumma salli, where he says, "Man yamutu bil-dhunub akthar mimman yamutu bil-ajal." The Imam says, the ones who die as a result of their sins are more than the ones who die because they reach their full lifespan. On the individual level, and this is also true when we speak about nations, just as a human being has a lifespan, nations also have lifespans. And if they transgress and if they defy and they reject the signs of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shortens their time of reign in the same way that He shortens the life of a human being because of their sins. In another hadith from Imam al-Ridha alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, "Idha kadhaba al-wulat hubis al-matar." The Imam says, when governors lie, when they perpetuate falsehood, when these individuals come to power, when people put corrupt leaders in power and they begin to lie and they're dishonest, rain is withheld. You see, again, the Ahlul Bayt explicitly telling us that our actions affect the amount of rain that falls from the sky. Our actions can actually cause natural disasters, and they can also cause us to live in prosperity. إِذَا كَذَبَ الْوُلَاةِ, Imam says, حُبِسَ الْمَطَرُ وَإِذَا جَارَ السُّلْطَانِ هَانَتِ الدَّوْلَةِ. When the ruler is corrupt and oppressive, the entire nation suffers humiliation. وَإِذَا حُبِسَتِ الزَّكَاتِ مَاتَتِ الْمَوَاشِي. The Imam says, when people withhold and they refuse to give their religious dues, their zakat, cattle begins to die. So you find that our actions have consequences in this life, and they also have consequences in the akhirah. And Allah tells us that the destruction that these civilizations met was a result of their actions, was a result of their sins. When you look at ayah number 6, you find that the word qarn is used. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what does He say? أَلَمْ يَرَوْا كَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ مِنْ قَرْنٍ. The word قَرْن literally means فَتْرَ طَوِيلَ مِنَ الزَّمَنِ. It means a long period of time. But here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking, He's not speaking about time, He's speaking about individuals that lived during that time. And qarn is used to describe a lengthy period of time. And this is also a very beautiful, subtle point that Allah is saying that these nations that I destroyed, Allah is not talking about nations or civilizations that lasted for 10, 15, 20, 50 years. Allah says, I brought down empires that spanned hundreds of years, civilizations that were powerful for hundreds of years, and because of their disobedience to me, I completely destroyed them. أَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ. I destroyed them in such a way I barely left a trace of them on the earth. That's why today, archaeologists, they have to search day and night. They have to excavate lands to be able to find traces of these past civilizations. Allah says, أَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ. We completely obliterated them. Then we turn to ayah number 7. Again, Allah speaking about the stubbornness of Quraysh, those who rejected, the kuffar of Mecca, who rejected the Holy Prophet. وَلَوْ نَزَّلْنَا, ayah number 7. وَلَوْ نَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ كِتَابًا فِي قِرْطَاسٍ فَلَمَسُوهُ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ لَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ. Now this verse, they're essentially saying, Allah is saying that if I send down a book, a written book, and they touch it with their hands, they will surely, the disbelievers will surely say that this is nothing but clear magic, it's sorcery. Now this verse may be a response to those who expected Rasulullah to bring a complete scripture in writing, as did Musa. You see, one of the stark differences between the revelation of the Quran and the revelation of the Torah is that Torah was revealed to Musa at one time. It wasn't revealed to Musa gradually. Whereas the Holy Quran was revealed gradually over a period of 23 years. So for example, in Surah Al-Furqan, Surah 25, ayah number 32, one of the protests, one of the objections of the disbelievers is what? وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا Surah 25, ayah 32. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنُ جُمْلَةً وَاحِدًا. Those who disbelieve say to you, O Muhammad, why was not the Quran revealed at one time, instantaneously? Meaning, in the same way that the Torah was revealed. In ayah number 28, in surah number 28, verse 48, Allah says, فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمُ الْحَقِّ مِنْ عِنْدِنَا When the truth came to them, قَالُوا لَوْلَا When it came to the Meccans, the Arabs, قَالُوا لَوْلَا أُوتِيَ مِثْلَ مَا أُوتِيَ مُوسَى Why was Muhammad not given revelation in the same way as Musa was given revelation? Allah says to them, أَوَلَمْ يَكْفُرُوا بِمَا أُوتِيَ مُوسَى مِنْ قَبْلِ Allah says, didn't you still reject Musa? So Allah is pointing out that these individuals are making excuses to reject divine scripture. Allah says, I revealed to Musa the Torah at one time. It wasn't a gradual revelation. And you still rejected him. With Muhammad, I revealed to him gradually. You still reject. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling them out. He's saying that these are all excuses. Do you believe in Musa? The Quraysh didn't believe in Musa. Some ulama believe this ayah is a response, this ayah number 7 from Surah Al-An'am, وَلَوْ نَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ كِتَابًا فِي قِرْطَاسِ This ayah is a response to ayah number 7, to Surah number 17, Surah Al-Isra, ayah number 93. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi went on his mi'raj, you can imagine the ridicule and the mockery the Holy Prophet faced at the hands of the Quraysh, of the Meccans. They wanted proof that Rasulullah went on Mi'raj. In ayah number 93 of Surah Al-Isra, what did they say? وَلَن نُؤْمِن لِرُقِيِّكَ حَتَّى تُنَزِّلَ عَلَيْنَا كِتَابًا نَقْرَأُ They say, we're not going to believe in your ascension to the heavens until you get for us a book that we can read. A book, a scripture from the heavens that we can read. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet that all of these requests that they're making, they are all lies, they're all excuses. In ayah number 7 of Surah Al-An'am, وَلَوْ نَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ كِتَابًا فِي قِرْطَاسِ قِرْطَاس is anything that you used to write on. It could be paper, it could be parchment. فَلَمَسُوهُ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ It's interesting that when you think of a book, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that if I send down a book in written form for them to touch with their hands, why doesn't Allah say so they can read it or see it with their eyes? Allah mentions touching this book with their hands. لَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ Number one, Allah is pointing out, and Allah knows best, that they're not interested in reading. That even if you give them what they're asking, they're not even going to read it. They're not interested in the truth. So they're not going to look at it with the intention of reading it. Other scholars say that touch is one of the five senses. The five senses, we have this, the sense of sight, hearing, taste, smell, and touch. One of the most powerful senses that we have is the sense of touch, a lems. When you touch something, you experience it on a deeper level than if you see it. Allah says, even if they were to experience this divine scripture in a way that's more powerful than the sense of sight, they would still reject it. لَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. And this lam in front of qal is for emphasis. Without a doubt, لَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ. They will accuse you of sorcery, of being a magician. And then we look at ayah number 8. So in ayah number 7, they ask for what? They ask for a written scripture, like the scripture that was revealed to Musa, something that they can touch, something that was revealed to Musa that's similar, something that that's not revealed gradually as the Quran. Here, their second request is what? وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا in ayah number 8, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ وَلَوْ أَنزَلْنَا مَلَكًا لَقُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ ثُمَّ لَا يُنظَرُونَ. And they would say, why has not an angel been sent down onto him? Had we sent down an angel, then the matter would be decreed, and they would not be granted no respite. So here, in ayah number 8, the kuffar of Quraysh, what are they asking? They say, if you're truly connected with Allah, if you're truly a messenger, why wasn't an angel sent? With you or instead of you? It's interesting to note that the polytheists of Mecca believe in malaika. They believe in angels. And perhaps this is one of the remnants of the Abrahamic tradition. You find that the tradition of Ibrahim alayhi salam began was propagated in the Arab lands through Ismail. And some of these beliefs remained in the hearts of the kuffar. So even though they worshiped idols, they retained certain correct beliefs, which in one of them is the belief in angels. But of course, this belief in angels also became corrupted later when they started to regard angels as the daughters of Allah. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. So here, as in several other verses, the disbelievers question Allah, question why Allah has not sent an angel either with the prophet or instead of a human prophet. And you find, again, there are many verses in the Quran where Allah mentions this request being made to the Holy Prophet. In Surah Al-Hijr, Surah 15, ayah number 7, Allah says, لَوْ مَا تَأْتِينَا بِالْمَلَائِكَةِ إِن كُنْتَ مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ. The kuffar would tell the Holy Prophet that why don't you bring all of the angels so we can see all of the malaika if you are truthful, if you truly are the messenger of God. So the first request is what? They want to see malaika. They want to see these unseen beings. In Surah 25, Surah Furqan, ayah number 7, again a similar request is made. وَقَالُوا مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولِ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامِ وَيَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ لَوْ لَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ فَيَكُونُ مَعَهُ نَذِيرًا. What do they say? What kind of Rasul is this? He eats food just like we eat food. He walks in the marketplace just like us. Meaning that what's the difference between you and us, O Muhammad? You're a human being. You eat, you drink. You have to go to the grocery store like us. If you are truly a messenger, why was not an angel sent along your side? by your side. فَيَكُونُ مَعَهُ نَذِيرًا. So the angel could also be a warner beside you. So you can have a partner in this angel. Surah 43, Ayah 53. Surah Zukhruf, Ayah 53. Again, what do they say? فَلَوْلَا أُلْقِيَ عَلَيْهِ أَسْوِرَةٌ مِّن ذَهَبٍ. They say, this Muhammad, if he's truly a messenger, why is he not decked out with gold? Again, in their minds, someone who's connected to Allah has to be able to summon angels, and he has to be walking around with angels, or he has to be materialistically very wealthy. فَلَوْلَا أُلْقِيَ عَلَيْهِ أَسْوِرَةٌ مِّن ذَهَبٍ أَوْ جَاءَ مَعَهُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ مُقْتَرِنِينَ. Why are there not angels accompanying him wherever he goes? Now, I want to share with you, my dear brothers and sisters, some ahadith about malaika. Because angels are mentioned in many verses in the Holy Quran, and some of us, we don't really have a very clear understanding about the nature of malaika, the creation of angels, and their functions. There's a hadith from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullahi alayhi. Where he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ خَلَقَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ مِنَ النُّورِ. Imam al-Sadiq, he says, indeed Allah created angels from light. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human being from earth, from turab, from tin, as we mentioned last week. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created jinn from a different source. He created jinn from what? وَخَلَقَ الْجَانَّ مِنْ مَارِجٍ مِنْ نَارٍ. As Allah says in Surah Ar-Rahman, He created jinn from a mixture of fire or smokeless fire, according to some verses. And Allah created angels from nur, from light. So you find that all of these three beings, because they're created from different sources, naturally they're going to have different dispositions. They're going to have different natures. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, in another hadith, he speaks about the sheer number of angels that Allah has created. The Imam alayhi salam, he says, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ. The Imam is swearing by Allah. لَمَلَائِكَةُ اللَّهِ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ أَكْثَرُ مِنْ عَدَدِ التُّرَابِ فِي الْأَرْضِ. The Imam says, I swear by Allah that the number of angels that inhabit the heavens are more than grains of sand on earth. وَمَا فِي السَّمَاءِ مَوْضِعُ قَدَمٍ إِلَّا وَفِيهَا مَلَكٌ يُسَبِّحُهُ وَيُقَدِّسُ. The Imam says, there is not a single inch in the heavens that is not occupied by an angel that is glorifying and praising Allah. وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ شَجَرٌ وَلَا مَدَرٌ إِلَّا وَفِيهَا مَلَكٌ مُوَكَّلٌ بِهَا. The Imam says, there is not a single tree on the earth or a single piece of soil that doesn't have an angel that is looking over it and protecting it and safeguarding it. The Imam is saying that there is nothing more abundant that Allah has created than malaika. And then the Imam says in another hadith, إِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَ لَا يَأْكُلُونَ وَلَا يَشْرَبُونَ وَلَا يَنْكِحُونَ وَإِنَّمَا يَعِيشُونَ بِنَسِيمِ الْعَرْشِ. The Imam says, angels do not eat. They don't eat food. They don't drink. وَلَا يَنْكَحُونَ. And they don't copulate. They don't get married and procreate. And this is important, brothers and sisters. If angels don't eat and they don't drink and they don't have carnal desires, it would make no sense for Allah to send an angel as a prophet or an angel as a messenger to guide and to lead and be an example for human beings, because People will argue on the day of Qiyamah that, oh Allah, you sent an angel to teach me, to guide me, to be my role model. They have a totally different nature. You need to send someone who has my same disposition, who has my same inclinations, who is human like me, so I can emulate. In the first khutbah of Nahjul Balagha, Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullahi alayhi, again, this is just, you know, some extra information about Malaika that inshallah you'll find useful. In the first khutbah of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the Imam speaks about the creation of the universe. He speaks about the creation of Adam. One of the things that the Imam speaks about in the first khutbah of Nahjul Balagha is the creation of angels. He speaks about Malaika. The Imam says, and if you want to read the entire khutbah, you'll find it in the first sermon, especially the section on angels. The Imam says, ثُمَّ فَتَقَ مَا بَيْنَ السَّمَاوَاتِ الْعُلَىٰ فَمَلَأَهُنَّ أَطْوَارًا مِّن مَلَائِكَتِهِ. The Imam says, when Allah opened the heavens, He filled it with different classes of angels. Here, from the onset, Imam is telling us that not all angels are the same. They have different roles. They have different functions. And then the Imam begins to list the different types of angels, the different classes of angels. مِنْهُمْ سُجُودٌ لَا يَرْكَعُونَ. The Imam says, there are some angels that are constantly in sujood. They never raise their head from sujood. From the moment Allah created them until now, they are in sujood. So if you and I, on the nights of Qadr, we go into sujood for 30 minutes, we shouldn't feel arrogant or proud. There are malaika who have been in sujood for their entire existence. وَرُكُوعٌ لَا يَنْتَصِبُونَ. The Imam says there are other malaika that are in ruku'. They're bowing to Allah and they never raise their heads. From the moment of their creation until now, they're bowing. وَصَافُونَ لَا يَتَزَايَلُونَ. And there are some angels that are standing upright and they don't move from their place. وَمُسَبِّحُونَ لَا يَسْأَمُونَ. There are angels that are constantly doing tasbih and they don't get tired. لَا يَغْشَاهُمْ نَوْمُ الْعُيُونَ. These angels, whether they're in sujood or ruku' or they're standing upright, they are never overtaken by the sleep of the eyes. They don't start dozing off. Like some people who are bored in a tafsir class, you start to doze off, right? Malaika, they don't get tired. وَلَا سَهُ الْعُقُولِ. Their wits are never dulled. وَلَا فَتْرَةُ الْأَبْدَانِ. Their bodies never get tired. وَلَا غَفْلَةُ النِّسْيَانِ. They never forget. وَمِنْهُمْ أُمَنَاءُ عَلَىٰ وَحْيِهِ. Some angels are the trustees of Allah's message, like Jibra'il. And Jibra'il seems to have aides who assist him. وَأَلْسِلَةٌ إِلَىٰ رُسُلِهِ. Some angels are given the responsibility of communicating messages to prophets, to messengers. وَمُخْتَلِفُونَ بِقَضَائِهِ وَأَمْرِهِ. There are angels that are ascending and descending through the heavens and the earth, fulfilling and executing divine commandments. وَمِنْهُمُ الْحَفَظَةُ لِعِبَادِ. And there are some angels who are commissioned with the responsibility of protecting Allah's servants. وَالسَّدَنَةُ لِأَبْوَابِ جِنَانِ. The Imam says there are some angels who were created for the sole purpose of being the gatekeepers of paradise, who greet the mu'mineen when they enter into Jannah. And then the Imam, he speaks about, and I'll conclude here with this excerpt from the section on Malaika. The Imam speaks about angels that are so massive and robust in size. وَمِنْهُمُ الثَّابِتَةُ فِي الْأَرَضِينَ السُّفْلَى أَقْدَامُهُمْ. The Imam says there are some angels that are so huge and robust that their feet are fixed on the earth والمارقة من السماء العليا أعناقهم. Their feet are fixed on the earth and their necks are protruding through the heavens. Imagine. We, brothers and sisters, we are totally oblivious of Alamul Ghayb. Believe me, if the curtain of the unseen were lifted, we would be overwhelmed with what we see. We would be overwhelmed. That's why Rasulullah, what does he say? An-nasu niyam idha matu intabahu. People are sleeping. People are heedless. They will wake up to the realities when they die. This is when they'll see Alamul Malakut, they'll see Malaika. They'll see that they were totally oblivious to what was actually happening around them. So what does Allah say? So this is a request that is made by the kuffar. Why wasn't an angel? It's clear that they don't even understand the nature of angels. They say, why wasn't an angel sent instead of Muhammad or with Muhammad? The response is what in the ayah? Allah says, لَقُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ. If I send an angel, the matter will be decreed, meaning that if I send an angel and you reject, I will immediately punish you, meaning I'm not going to even allow you, I won't grant you respite. I won't give you a window of time for repentance. You see, most of the time when Allah decides, you, for example, if you take the community of Lut, Allah punished them at dawn. Why didn't He punish them at night? He gave them the night to maybe come back and do Tawbah. But here Allah says, if I send an angel, it would be such a clear, incontrovertible sign of the truth that if you were to disbelieve after this, you would be destroyed without any opportunity to repent. Because at that point, Haq will be too clear to reject. This is one opinion that is put forward. Other ulama, they say no. The very sight of an angel in its actual form is so powerful and overwhelming that it would cause your immediate death. Meaning, in the same way that you and I cannot stand certain radiation, we'll die because it's too overwhelming for us, Allah is saying, Malaika are beings that are unseen. If you were to witness an angel in its pure form, your flesh and blood, O human being, you would not be able to withstand the powerful sight of an angel in its pure form. And you find that in the Quran, it's interesting, it seems that only Rasulullah was able to see an angel in its pure form. Everyone else is too weak to withstand the sight and is not able to encounter an angel directly in their pure form. Only the Holy Prophet, only Rasulullah has a soul that is strong enough to be able to witness an angel in their actual form. If you go to Surah An-Najm, Allah mentions that Rasulullah saw Jibra'il in his actual form, not in a disguised form, two times. Surah 53, verses 5 through 7, Allah says what? عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَى. Muhammad was taught by the one with mighty strength, meaning Jibra'il. ذُو مِرَّةٍ فَاسْتَوَى. Jibra'il has incredible power that was given to him by Allah. ذُو مِرَّةٍ فَاسْتَوَى. Jibra'il erected himself. He manifested himself to Rasulullah in his actual form. وَهُوَ بِالْأُفُقِ الْأَعْلَى. Rasulullah saw the actual image of Jibra'il on the highest point of the horizon. This is the first time. In the same surah, Surah 53, verses 13 to 14, Allah says what? وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى عِنْدَ سِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَى. When Rasulullah was on his mi'raj, again he saw Jibra'il in his actual form at Sidrat al-Munsa, which is a tree in the highest levels of paradise. Others, when they encounter Jibra'il, Jibra'il is not in his actual form. He's in human form. For example, when Jibra'il came to Maryam, did Jibra'il appear to Maryam in his actual form, or was he disguised as a human being? In Surah 19, Ayah 17, Allah says, فَاتَّخَذَتْ مِن دُونِهِمْ حِجَابًا. Maryam, salamullahi alayha, she secluded herself. Her parents dedicated her to the sanctuary, the temple where she was worshiping. فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهَا, she was engaged in ibadah. Allah says, فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهَا رُوحَنَا, we sent to her our spirit, meaning Jibra'il. He's known as الروح الأمين. فَتَمَثَّلَ, Jibra'il appeared to her, how? فَتَمَثَّلَ لَهَا بَشَرًا سَوِيًّا, Jibra'il appeared to Maryam in the form of a complete, perfect man. When the angels visited Ibrahim, when they gave him the tidings of a birth of a son, and when they gave him the news that the community of Lut is going to be destroyed, they came in the form of men. That's why Ibrahim, he brings meat and he puts it in front of them, and when they don't eat, he becomes afraid of them. He finds that strange. So all other prophets, all other awliya, when they encounter malaika, they always encounter angels in human form, that they come in the outward form of a human being, because the sight of an angel is so overwhelming that it would destroy the people if they were to see the angel in its actual form. So as we mentioned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if I send an angel, the matter will be decreed. Either I will punish you immediately because there's no room for rejecting such a clear sign, or you don't understand what you're asking. You cannot withstand the sight of an angelic being because you are weak and you are made of flesh and bone, and angels are too powerful for you to withstand and experience in a direct way. And then Allah Azza wa Jal says in ayah number 10. Completing the ayah, going back to ayah number 9, وَلَوْ جَعَلْنَاهُ مَلَكًا لَجَعَلْنَاهُ رَجُلًا وَلَلَبَسْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مَا يَلْبَسُونَ. Allah here says, if we were to send an angel, again, this is supporting the opinion of those who say we cannot withstand the sight of an angel in their actual form. Allah says, if I were to send an angel as a messenger, I would have to disguise them as human beings. I would have to make them in human form because you would not be able to withstand them in their actual form. And for them to serve as your role models, they have to resemble you. They have to possess human qualities. They have to have the same nature, the same passions, the same desires, the same emotions as human beings. In ayah number 10, Allah says, وَلَقَدِ اسْتُهْزِئَ بِرُسُلٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ. Allah says to the Holy Prophet, again, you can imagine that it's been over 10 years, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi has been propagating, he's been inviting these people to Islam. They would stone him, they would mock him, they would ridicule him, they would physically assault him on occasions, to such an extent that Rasulullah would say, مَا أُوذِيَ نَبِيٌ بِمِثْلِ مَا أُوذِيتَ. No prophet has suffered as I have suffered. Allah tells the Prophet, وَلَقَدِ اسْتُهْزِئَ بِرُسُلٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ. O Muhammad, do not be distressed. You are being mocked, but you're not the first Rasul mocked. Nuh was mocked before you. Musa was mocked. Ibrahim was mocked and ridiculed. Isa was mocked. All of the messengers, they experienced the verbal abuse and the slander that you are now experiencing. فَحَاقَ بِالَّذِينَ سَخِرُوا مِنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا بِهِ يَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. When the Holy Prophet would warn them of the day of Qiyamah, when he would warn them of the imminent punishment that lies ahead, they would make fun of the Prophet. They would mock the Holy Prophet, saying, bring down the punishment if what you are saying is truthful. Allah is telling the Prophet, the messengers before you were mocked when they used to warn their communities of divine wrath. فَحَاقَ بِالَّذِينَ سَخِرُوا مِنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا بِهِ يَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. Messengers have surely been mocked before you. Then those who mocked them were encircled by that which they used to ridicule. When Nuh alayhi salam, for example, told his community that there is a flood coming, they would mock him. They would, when rain began to fall, they would say, this is the rain that's going to cause the great flood. But what they mocked the flood, but when the flood came, it destroyed them, it encircled them. So the punishment that they used to mock and make fun of, Allah says, I will send it down in such a way, فَحَاقَ بِالَّذِينَ سَخْرُمْ. It will encircle them to such an extent they will not have a way out. When Allah decides to punish a nation, Allah sends down His punishment in such a way that it encompasses all of them. Not a single one of them is able to escape. وَلَقَدْ اسْتُهْزِئَ بِرُسُلٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ فَحَاقَ بِالَّذِينَ سَخِرُوا مِنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا بِهِ يَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. You find, brothers and sisters, that today we speak a lot about, you know, the rise in Islamophobia. As Muslims, we're ridiculed, we're told to go back to our countries. Sisters who wear the hijab are verbally abused. You know, the list of insults is very long. The first victim of Islamophobia was not you and I. It was Rasulullah himself. In fact, when the Islamophobic rhetoric became so severe and so intolerable, Allah reveals to the Holy Prophet, because Rasulullah is a human being. You know, Rasulullah feels emotional pain. He experiences physical pain and distress. Allah tells the Holy Prophet in Surah Hijr, Surah 15, verses 97 to 99, وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُ. O Muhammad, we know that your heart is distressed because of what they say. They call you majnoon, they call you insane, they call you sahir, they call you a madman, a soothsayer. We know that their words cause you distress. In the next ayah, Allah gives advice to the first victim of Islamophobia. What's Allah's advice? فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَكُمْ مِنَ السَّاجِدِينَ. Praise and glorify your Lord and be among those who prostrate. What's Allah's advice to the first victim of Islamophobia? Compromise, assimilate. Allah says, be unapologetically Muslim. Strive to please me. Remember me. Because when you're in, when the entire world is trying to agitate you, the only way to calm your heart is through dhikr of Allah. Ala bidhikri Allah tatma'innul qulub. As the saying goes, you cannot calm the storm, so stop trying. What you can do is calm your heart, because the storm will eventually pass. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to bless us and to guide us and to illuminate our hearts with the teachings of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala ahli bayti at-tayyibin at-tahirin.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
One of the main topics that you covered today is the rejection of truth. And now, is the level of accepting the truth and rejecting the truth Is that a black and white? Is that a binary state? And if we can assume that we are among those who have accepted the truth, is there anything where we are obviously lacking in that area?
Brother, your voice cut off a little bit. Can you repeat the question?
I can come closer.
Yes.
So my question is, is the level of accepting the truth or rejecting the truth, is that a white and black? Can we draw a line and say these people has accepted the truth and these are the people that didn't accept? And can we, and if we can assume that we are on the right side among those people that have accepted the truth, is there anything that in that gray area, if there is a gray area in between, is there something that you could say the today's Muslim community is lacking in accepting the truth in some portion of the truth?
Ahsant, it's a very good question. I think your question boils down to what has to be accepted to qualify as being a Muslim. You know, if you think about it, the fuqaha, they say, obviously someone who rejects tawheed is not Muslim. Someone who rejects qiyam is not Muslim. Someone who rejects that Allah sent prophets, someone who rejects Quran, angels, scriptures of the past is not Muslim. Someone who rejects anything of daruriyat al-deen, something that is so black and white. For example, someone that says prayer is not wajib, that hajj is not mandatory. These established teachings within the faith, rejecting any of these things takes you outside of the fold of Islam. Yani they call it inkar daruriyun min daruriyat al-deen. So with that, there it is black and white to a certain extent. Rejecting some of these main core beliefs takes you out of the fold of Islam. Now, when it comes to other matters, you know, for example, someone may reject a certain historical incident. That doesn't mean that they have rejected the truth. Now, if this historical incident, for example, like is mutawatir, for example, like the incident of Ghadir, you know, technically someone who says that I have doubt about Ghadir, technically they're still Muslim, even though they'll be held responsible because they've rejected something that is mutawatir, that has been transmitted through so many different channels that it's impossible that it's concocted or it's a lie. Now, so anything that is mutawatir, anything that is considered a fundamental belief in the Islamic tradition, rejecting that makes you a rejecter of truth. But other issues that do not have as much evidence, having doubt about it doesn't necessarily mean that you've rejected truth. Now, when it comes to the Muslim Ummah today, do our communities reject something that is considered haq without necessarily being aware of it? I can't think of anything off of the top of my head, but I definitely think that our communities have not given the Quran its due right. In the sense that I think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold us responsible for neglecting the Holy Quran. Now, it's one thing to call ourselves Muslims, but if we don't have a relationship with the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will definitely hold us responsible. In fact, there's a tradition where someone asks Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, Ya ibn Rasulillah, why did Allah mandate recitation of Quran in our daily prayers? Why is it that in the first rak'ah and in the second rak'ah, we have to recite Surah Al-Fatiha and another surah? The Imam alayhi salam, he says, if it wasn't for the Quran that we recite in our salah, many people would have no connection to the Quran. They'd have no connection to them. And if you look at it today, most Muslims, the only time they recite Quran is in their salah because Allah mandated it upon them. So I think if we establish a strong relationship with the Holy Quran, we'll be able to address a lot of the misconceptions, a lot of the ambiguities, and our standard for what is haq and what is batil will be a lot more clear, because the Quran is the standard, that you accept something as truth if it's compatible with the Quran, and you reject something as falsehood if it's incompatible with the Quran.
Maulana?
Yes.
You mentioned that when a community has sinned a lot, then they get destroyed. Is it always the case that if a community sins to a large extent, that they're completely destroyed, or is it can also be a partial situation?
You see, when it comes to the destruction of these nations, there are the sinners, the transgressors. You know, there's a hadith where Allah reveals to Shu'aib, saying, "Oh Shu'aib," and the community of Shu'aib was notorious for their unethical business practices. Allah says to Shu'aib, "Ya Shu'aib, I am punishing 100,000 from your community." And he says, 40,000 are sinners and 60,000 are good doers." Shu'aib says, "Oh Allah, I understand why you would punish the sinners. Why are you punishing the good doers?" He says, "Because they abandon Amr bil Ma'ruf wa Nahy anil Munkar." So even if someone is not actively sinning, they may be included in the punishment because they were not actively enjoining good and forbidding evil. So your silence makes you guilty, because the only way falsehood and sin and corruption spreads in society is when good people remain silent. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes communities, these communities, even if there are people who didn't actively participate in the sinning, but they were indirect participants through their silence. Their silence is considered a form of condonement.
I have a follow-up question. Maulana, something that I'm trying to understand in that regard is, what you're saying is that our actions are part of the accepting the truth. It's not just our words or just believing something in the heart. It's not enough to say, "I have accepted the truth." Is that true?
You're saying that belief has to be manifest. Yeah. Belief has to be manifested through action. In fact, that's one of the difference between Islam and Iman. There's a hadith from the Ahlul Bayt that says, "Al-Islamu alani." Islam is what is visible. Someone says, "La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah." But Iman is something that is in the heart. But what is in the heart is manifested through what? Amal Salih. That there are indicators of the presence of faith in the heart.
Thank you.
Did that answer your question or no?
Yes, thank you.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
Possible to explain more this Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahy anil Munkar, how we can do it in our daily life and how we can participated with it.
Now, in the books of fiqh, there's a section on the ahkam of Amr bil Ma'ruf wa Nahy anil Munkar. Now, before you can enjoin good and forbid evil, you have to know what is Munkar and what is Ma'ruf. You have to be familiar with what is wajib and what is haram. In many cases, you may see someone doing something which is not technically haram. So if you're not well-versed in fiqh, in the wajibat and the muharramat, you're not qualified to do Amr bil Ma'ruf wa Nahy anil Munkar. So you need to first be familiar with what is Ma'ruf and what is Munkar. Secondly, you're only obligated, according to many fuqaha, to enjoin good if you feel that if you're relatively sure that your words are going to have an effect. So if I know with certainty that if I advise this person, they're not going to listen. You're not obligated to, according to some fuqaha. So if you see that there is potential for you to correct a misdeed, then you should. But if you know for certainty that no change is going to take place, you're not obligated to. Thirdly, if you know, if there's a possibility that enjoining good or forbidding evil in a certain circumstances is going to put you in danger, or it's going to put you in a very difficult situation, again, you're not obligated to. Inshallah, you know, one day, if I'm reminded to, I can maybe go through some of the ahkam of Amr bin Ma'ruf wa Nahy an al-Munkar. But just, you know, in a nutshell, there are some conditions that have to be met for you to, and obviously there are three levels. There are three levels of Amr bin Ma'ruf. The first is the level of the heart. This is wajib ayni. When you see something haram, you have to reject it at the level of the heart. This is something that always has to be there. That when you see batil, you have to denounce it at the level of the heart. If circumstances allow you, then you should speak, provided that the other conditions are met. And if you can do more than speak, if you actually have power, then you should do more than just speak. You should take action with your hands and use the resources at your disposal.
Assalamu alaikum, Anand. Thank you on behalf of all the people in this room. We thank you for your time and effort in teaching us. Jazakallah khair.
Allah bless. Keep in your dua, inshallah, and inshallah we'll meet again next week.
Inshallah.
Fi imanillah. Assalamu alaikum.